Senate reform has been left until the Supreme Court makes its ruling. There was one change that's been made just recently, and Mr. Goodenough and I were just talking about it tonight, that the leader of the Liberals, Mr. Trudeau, has made a change in terms of saying that the senators in the Senate who were Senate Liberal senators are no longer part of the Liberal caucus, the National Caucus. And so we'll have to see how that change will play itself out in terms of does it make a change in terms of the organization of the Senate internally. It's an interesting thing, though, in terms of the Senate and our Constitution and our creation of Canada. In the first 95 years of the Senate's existence, there were 5 attempts at Senate reform. In the last approximately 51 years, there have been 17 attempts at Senate change, Senate reform. It's also an interesting thing to watch the history of it, that Senate reform tends to be cyclical and it comes up approximately every 10 years. Watch that, and whether we'll get change this time or not, I don't know, or it might be another 10 years. So with all of this constitutional talk, I thought I would just take you back to when this country was formed, the Fathers of Confederation, 1867. Interestingly enough, in that 1864 to 67 period of time, with the constitutional discussions on forming Canada, more than half of the time was spent on discussing the Senate and discussing what it would look like, what its powers would be, whether it be elected, whether it be appointed. And that was the crux of all of the discussions at that time, was what were they going to do with the Senate. And there was quite a bit of support for elected Senates, upper chambers, because the partners entering Confederation had upper chambers and were elected, but that was becoming less of the popular mode and more like they wanted to have nominated or appointed senators. And so they looked to the House of Lords in the UK, and they looked to the Senate in the United States for examples, both of whom had upper chambers that were appointed. And you're saying, no, whoa, the United States has elected Senate. And they do, but they didn't in 1867. They were appointed. And so that was the model that the Fathers of Confederation in forming Canada looked at in terms of having appointed senators. The Constitution took on a great life of its own in terms of the discussions about the Senate, what it was going to do. Quebec was the key component of all of that in terms of saying that the Senate was absolutely necessary to protect their language and their culture. They could see that the French language, people speaking French, would be very much in a minority, and even more so as time went on, as the English population was increasing in Ontario and other provinces. And so the Senate became that cornerstone of ensuring linguistic and cultural rights for the Quebecois. And so Quebec agreed that they would have 24 seats. Why 24? In the tradition of Quebec at that time, and bear in mind that Quebec is just a long, slim piece along the St. Lawrence River in 1867. It was much, much later that it was expanded up into the Northwest Territories. There were 24 seats in that original section of Quebec, and so there are 24 seats in the Senate. And interestingly enough, even today, to be a senator, there aren't senators for all of Quebec. Each of the 24 senators represents one of those small electoral districts within Quebec. And I remember hearing the discussion as one senator from Quebec was leaving and somebody else they knew were going to be appointed, they had to make sure that they had property, not within Quebec, but within that small one segment of the province of Quebec. But if Quebec got 24 seats, then of course Ontario got 24 seats. And again, Ontario was much smaller then than it is today. So then what to do with Atlantic Canada? Nova Scotia got 10, New Brunswick got 10, and PEI, when it joined, got 4. Magically enough, it's 24. And when the West all became part of the formula, there are 4 Western provinces, each getting 6 seats. Guess what, it's another 24. So it all balances out until 1949, and Newfoundland spoiled it all by them getting 6 and didn't match any of the 24. But that's how, and then we have the three territories, that adds up to 105. In 1867, the Senate was given the same powers as the House of Commons, with one exception. The Senate was not allowed to introduce money bills. In other words, introduce initiatives for the spending of money. But it had a full and absolute veto. Anything coming out of the House of Commons, the Senate could just plain say no, and that was the bill would be dead. And that exists still today with one exception. I'll talk about that in a moment. The senators had to be landowners. Of course, they were men at that time, because women didn't have the vote until roughly 1916 onward. So they had to own land, they had to be 30 years of age, and they had to have property worth $4,000. You can see how they were designing the Senate to be a sober second thought, a counterbalance to the House of Commons, which was elected. And bear in mind, too, in 1867, shortly after that, elections really were a fairly new concept. And people were saying, I don't know if we can really trust this whole concept of giving everybody the chance to choose who the government will be. I mean, look at that person over there. They have a vote. Would that be very sensible? We need to counterbalance this wild revolutionary idea of elections by having people who are appointed. A little older, 30 years old, property. They'd be more mature and be able to counterbalance that radical House of Commons. Interestingly enough, the first push for reform in the Senate came only 7 years after Confederation. In 1874, one of the members of the House of Commons, David Mills, made the radical suggestion that the Senate needed to be reformed. He proposed that the provinces should select their own senators, but nothing ever happened to that solution or to that proposal. In 1926, Robert McKay wrote a book entitled The Unreformed Senate. 1926. So we think this is a new idea. It's been around for quite a while. And no change happened with regard to that until 1965, when the retirement age, and I should have mentioned that, when the Senate was created, the retirement age, it was an appointment for life. You died there. You could retire, but you could stay on as a senator until you died. In 1965, that was changed so that the retirement age was 75, which is still the case today. In 1976, the government proposed creating a House of Regents, where the provinces would have the power to select their senators, but again, that didn't pass. In 1982, the absolute veto, so I described to you what an absolute veto is, that they have the absolute power to say no to anything coming from the House of Commons. They have the power to amend and send it back, or the absolute veto power. In 1982, that was changed so that they had suspensive veto on any legislation concerning changes to the Senate. Otherwise, they still have absolute veto. And the only other change was, as each new province was added to Confederation, there were new senators, in terms of numbers, added to the Senate. So there's a wee bit of a brief history of Senate reform, and I've only covered a few of, as I said, the many different attempts. So what are the solutions, or what are the possible solutions? I think the first one is abolition. The NDP have argued that since its creation, and they don't have any members in the Senate. They had a chance once, not that long ago. Senator Dick from Saskatchewan said she wished to sit as an NDP senator, and the party said no. And so she didn't then sit as NDP. So the NDP don't have any senators, and they've argued long and hard for years, decades, that they would like to see the upper chamber abolished. And they've been joined recently by Premier Wall, who also has made statements to say that he's given up on Senate change and that it should be abolished.